Hi, welcome to part two of our discussion. The last time we spoke, I was talking about austerity, okay, which I represented as a limitation, or rather a limit of fiscal policy. Okay, so if you guys still recall, I talked about austerity from three angles. The first one refers to how it works, okay, how austerity works. Then I talked about the limitations of the effectiveness of an austerity policy. So I brought in GRIT, okay, as the acronym here. And the final section considered how austerity affects Singapore. Okay, so how, limitations, and impact on Singapore. Today, we are going to use the same 3 points, okay, to consider quantitative easing. Okay, this theme of quantitative easing should not be new to a number of students. Actually, in the real world, it started with Japan in the 2000s, okay? Then US also brought this in. Actually, the advisor who recommended this policy to Japan was Ben Bernanke, who was the ex-Federal Reserve Chairman of US. So naturally, this solution was brought to US. And now Europe is also embarking on quantitative easing. So what exactly is QE, okay, for short? We must first understand that QE is used when traditional monetary policy has been stretched to its limits. Okay? When you think of an interest rate policy, okay, primarily one that's expansionary in nature, when this policy has been stretched, that means your interest rates, okay, have been cut until they're close to 0%. Okay? This is what we call a liquidity trap. So once this level has been reached, reliance on this traditional mechanism doesn't work anymore. Okay, so when we talk about monetary policy that works through interest rate effects, we call this the indirect mechanism. Okay, so basically the indirect mechanism is dead. You can't push it anymore. Okay, in fact, pushing it further is like pushing on a string. It can't really work that well. So if that's the problem here, we have to focus on the direct mechanism. Okay, of how monetary policy works. And this is where QE comes in. So a student can think of QE as an extreme form of monetary policy. Okay, so this is extremely expansionary in nature, and it involves printing large amounts of cheap cash, okay, to stimulate the economy. So to understand how it works, okay, again, you can refer to my guidebook, where I discuss how quantitative easing works, okay? So, I mentioned that the indirect mechanism cannot work anymore, so we are tapping on the direct mechanism, okay? So what you're doing is you're flooding an economy with cheap cash. Really, the main aim is to boost AD, okay? So how it works involves buying of bonds, which we sometimes refer to as open market operations, okay? When the central bank buys bonds, okay, it is putting money in the hands of bond sellers. So you can see this as a mechanism through which money supply can be raised, all right? So what happens when more money is out there, okay? If you think back to the factors that affect consumption. Now, we don't just talk about the cost of credit as a factor that affects consumption. The availability of credit is also another factor, okay? So if there are more credit houses giving out loans, where getting a loan is more readily available, okay? Clearly, consumption rises too. Okay, firms can also gain access to funds to invest in new goods or to expand their industries. So this leads to a rise in AD, okay, because consumption and investment expenditure rises, or both rise. Okay? So suppose consumers, okay, spend more on, say, now there's extra cash, they invest it in the stock market or in the property market. Okay, some firms may do the same. When spending on stocks and property rises, okay, this creates an increase in the price, okay, of stocks and properties. A basic understanding of demand and supply here. Okay, so when stock and property prices go up, we refer to these as assets. Okay, an asset is anything that's of value to us. So when asset prices go up, try to think of what other asset owners would feel. Okay, suppose I own a certain number of shares in company ABC, and now a lot of people are investing in the stock market, okay? Because with QE, they can gain access to funds. So when the stock market rises, the price of my stocks or my shares in company ABC also rises. So what happens? I feel wealthier. Okay, the wealth effect is also a factor that affects consumption. So when I feel wealthier, I will consume even more. Alright? So you can see C and I rises and C rises here. Now furthermore, when money is being printed, you can think of it as a well, right? A well that's spewing out a lot of cash. Some of this money, right, lands in the hands of investors who decide that maybe it's a better idea to invest this money overseas. Okay? So this happened in the US. When investors got hold of cheap cash, they decided that maybe the investment prospects in US are not very good. I should bring this money to Brazil to invest in coffee beans, to Hong Kong or to Singapore to invest in property, right? Because land is scarce, property prices will rise when the population goes up. So some hot money could flow out of the country practicing QE. When this happens, okay, your exchange rate depreciates, okay? And we all know if MLC holds, your balance of trade also improves. So that's another stimulant to AD. Okay? And finally, if the first three effects, 1, 2, 3, are successful in raising inflation, okay? We have this equation where nominal interest rates minus inflation rates, okay, gives you real interest rates. So let's suppose when we do QE, because we are the liquidity trap, this is probably 0%. And if inflation goes up to 2%, that means real interest rates become negative 2%. Effectively, what it means is that if you put money in the bank, you're hardly earning any interest, right? But at the same time, price levels are rising at the rate of 2%. So the real purchasing power of your savings are bleeding away, okay? When this happens, it's a disincentive to save and it spurs further spending, okay? So the 4 points here will summarize how QE works or how it's intended to work. But again, I can tell you, if expectations are very poor, no amount of money printed will stimulate spending, right, to the level that you want. So main limitation here, expectations, okay? And that's also the reason why US needed to run through so many rounds of QE, okay, before it helped to stimulate the economy. And if you consider the impact on Singapore, again, we can look at a DICE approach, D-I-C-E, okay? So in terms of direct impact, again, we can try to link QE to export sales for Singapore, okay? Because when hot money flows to Singapore, the Sing dollar becomes stronger. So this may lower net exports. And the impact on growth, unemployment, BOP, and inflation, students can derive on their own, okay? But we must not forget that the backdrop to QE is very low interest rates in US. So since Singapore's rates are tied to US rates, okay, this also means that when we have low interest rates, consumption and investment in Singapore also rises, okay? And if let's say this consumption is directed into property investments, asset price inflation, which is another form of inflation, may rise, okay? But let's not forget, the aim of QE is to help the US economy. So if let's say in the long run, it does improve economic prospects in US, our export sales will start to recover, okay? So under the direct impact, you can see all four goals are already covered. So we may not need to delve into indirect impacts, okay? And as part of DICE, we will also consider counteracting measures, okay? So if let's say QE results in high property prices and asset price inflation, what Singapore can do and what we have done, okay, is to increase stamp duties. Right, stamp duties are effectively taxes. You can think of a duty as a tax, which is the same as a levy or a tariff, right? The context is slightly different only. So having taxes also discourages people from investing in property, and this helps to lower asset price inflation, right? Evaluation, same thing. Look at nature and state. So nature of Singapore economy being we are small and open, okay? So when that happens, the foreign exports will have a big impact on growth. Okay, notwithstanding the small multiplier. And the backdrop, right, state of economy, our growth is likely to be slow. If US is slowing down, we should be slowing down, right? So, okay, this is not austerity here, this is QE. Okay? You will see this edit made in the revised version, but not in my soft copy, okay? So evaluation-wise, you can actually weave in the Singapore context by talking about the fact that growth in Singapore could be low, and also, the nature of the economy such that we are export driven. So the effects of QE will be felt quite significantly in Singapore. Okay, again, I want to keep the structure broad. So DICE gives you the four broad points to consider. Students can decide how they want to roll up these points, how they want to add on definitions, diagrams, explanations, and examples, which I'll explain in my classes, and I'm sure your teachers will do the same for you. Okay, so same thing. If you have questions for me, this is the email to write to thateconstutor, okay, at gmail.com. Okay, if you want to visit me on my website, it's www.thateconstutor.com. Okay, I hope you find this useful. If there are topics that you want me to run through, please feel free to drop me a message as well. Okay, thank you.